Peter, at last check, StatsCan was reporting 7.8% in terms of unemployment in Canada. Restrictions in travel have made it a little more difficult with respect to immigration, which is a key driver when it comes to housing. And foreign buyers have been put on the sidelines. In your latest forecast, you're suggesting that there will be some turbulence, but later in the year, housing will return to an upward path. As a matter of fact, I believe it suggests 5 to 10% year over year gain. I have to ask, Peter, it seems like a rather optimistic prognosis.
So, of course, context is important for everything, and there's a lot of stuff in motion right now. So it's kind of a little bit of a difficult time to be forecasting given all of that. But that being said, what's important to me is ensuring that we understand how things are evolving through the negative part and then how it's coming back and then what the implications that might have for housing. My message primarily in this forecast environment is that don't underestimate how fast things may come back. Now, with respect to the economy and the demographic side, both of which you've made reference to, obviously, second quarter, even well into the third quarter, it's going to be a disaster zone. And we're going to be seeing a lot of additional high frequency data that starts coming out about April pretty soon and about May and about June, that's going to look pretty dismal. But this is not a recession. This is not an ordinary recession. This is not a recession that was caused by economic antecedents. It is primarily a recession that's caused by the health crisis. And we see that as containment measures in particular start coming off, even though they will not come off completely, probably for quite a number of quarters, as they start coming off and as people start getting back to normal with their spending and with their investing and with the way that they're running their lives, I suppose, we'll also see a lot of sectors start to come back very quickly. I think housing will be one of those. Now, importantly, one of the things that when you mentioned 5 to 10%, I think that I'm talking about the pricing at this point in time, because everybody's kind of interested in that. And my main message is we won't expect pricing to go down a lot during the negative time. It's not a negative spiral. It's not a housing crash. We'll certainly see perhaps some negative numbers, some positive numbers. It'll be all over the map in the next number of months. But by the time we get to the end of the year and things are coming back and momentum is coming back and there's pent-up demand from the downtime and supply is coming back on stream in terms of the resale market and in terms of new home construction, I expect we'll see a lot of activity in there. Certainly, we see migration really weak this year, and that has been a kind of a macro driver for housing in general. But right now, what's going to be driving the market in the fall is that pent-up demand from domestic demand, I would say.
Now, a big component also of housing is open houses. And of course, you know, because of social distancing and various safety measures in place. And as we see governments, you know, unveil these paths to recovery, and with the, I guess, lifting of some of these restrictions, of these measures, will this propel the market? I mean, you seem to suggest in your forecast that we'll see this sharp resumption again of sales and, I guess, of open houses.
Technology. Perhaps that's the new acronym where we used to have location. Maybe it's both. But nonetheless, there are no open houses now in most parts of the country, for sure. And that's an impediment to having a housing sales transaction. Another impediment is the fact that there's not very much supply. People are not listing their houses for sale, and builders are not coming forward with new projects and, you know, new sales centers. All of those things are impediments. As we start to normalize and as the containment measures come off, so too will a lot of these kinds of physical restrictions in the marketplace. You'll start to see realtors having open houses. You'll start to see sales centers opening up for new projects again. But perhaps, well, importantly, and perhaps even more importantly, we're already seeing both of those channels turn to technology in a very big way in all sorts of areas. We see realtors doing virtual open houses and using a variety of other tools in order to communicate with their clients. We see home builders doing virtual sales centers using e-signing and a variety of other newly allowed techniques in order to get transactions done, and that's starting to happen as well. Still baby steps, but I would say by the time we get to September, October, November, et cetera, as we move into the well into the fourth quarter and into the beginning of next year, I think what we're going to be seeing is a kind of a combination where a lot of these kinds of workaround techniques are working very well for a lot of the sales sector. In addition, we're going to start to see some in-person transactions starting to happen as well. And all of those things will assist those who are looking to purchase to in fact facilitate those transactions.
I'm curious about what this national picture looks like. I mean, provinces in Canada that have been really hard hit because of COVID-19, Quebec, Alberta, and Alberta, of course, suffering pre-coronavirus. What does your homework, if you will, tell us about provinces like this?
Yeah. I mean, as we go across the country, obviously the severity of the health crisis has been a precursor for how severe the containment measures are. And of course, the containment measures are the thing that's having the most impact on the economy. So areas like BC, that is a large province, but hasn't been that hit that hard by the health crisis, we'll see the containment measures coming off perhaps more quickly. And you might see that there's a lot more pickup in that province before there is one, say, in Quebec. Ontario might be sort of in between. So there's going to be a little bit of jockeying that goes on from that perspective. But nonetheless, we sort of see that from a national picture, and even in some of these provinces that are hardest hit, the timing might be off by a number of months, but that as we get into the fourth quarter and first quarter, we expect economic recovery to be taking place. And I'll just kind of add to this, because some of my remarks might just seem overly optimistic going into this. And it wasn't my intent to be just, oh, everything's fine, don't worry about anything. It's not so much that. This is a severe economic crisis that we're in right now. Even by the time we get to the end of the year and we look at this year as a whole, GDP will be impacted to the order of about 5% or perhaps 6% in a negative way for the year as a whole. We haven't seen a recession like that, even during the last big recession in 2009. People's income will be affected, and that will have impacts on housing and others. All I'm really saying in terms of the dynamic, in terms of us getting back to normal, is we'll see a surge in activity when we start to open up from our shelter at home orders, and we start to get back into a more normal rhythm. 2021, will it be as good as what we were expecting prior to this whole crisis? I think it'll be a bit subdued, but nonetheless, we're not going into a crash and things are not spiraling down out of control. We're going to get more or less back to normal. And the fourth quarter is going to show that, the impacts of us getting back to normal by having these kinds of, I think, positive price effects.
I want to go back to something that you had mentioned a little earlier on in the conversation, and that was these builders who are sitting on the sidelines. In your forecast, it suggests that housing starts and construction is going to be looking at about 160,000 this year for 2020.
That's right.
Can you compare that to previous years, or perhaps what does a forecast look like?
So to contextualize that, we're calling now for something between about 150 and 160,000 housing starts for this year, for 2020 as a whole. And to contextualize that, prior to this crisis, we were forecasting about 215,000. So we're basically talking about a hit of somewhere between about 50 and 60,000 lower housing starts this year than we would have had under normal circumstances. That's a big impact. This takes us back to the kind of lower bound that we've seen in some other crises. So in 2009, for example, when the last big recession hit, we also had housing starts nationally that were around 150,000 units. So it's going to be a similar year to that in some respects. And if we go back to the early 1990s, we actually had about 5 years in a row that averaged 150,000. So that was what people can remember as being not just a hit to housing, but a prolonged hit. So what differentiates my forecast and my view of the way things are going to evolve this time around relative to the early 1990s, for example, is that it will be a similar hit right away. We've got a severe recession, and housing is housing starts are being impacted by that. But it's not going to be a prolonged impact. We're going to see things coming back even as we get into the fourth quarter, nonetheless into 2021.
With respect to commercial real estate, we've seen a lot of businesses on the verge of bankruptcy. What's the path going forward for commercial real estate?
Yeah, there's a lot of questions, obviously, about commercial real estate. And obviously, we're looking at this very closely. And it's an evolving situation as we see it going. Without a doubt, we're going to see revenues for landlords being impacted by either temporary rent abatement or, as you're suggesting, you know, as if tenants go bankrupt, that may be, you know, longer amount of rent abatement. So that's going to have an implication on that sector. And it's going to be a little bit different by segment as well. I mean, the industrial sector probably is doing very well because it's not being impacted by this so much in all markets. Plus, there's a lot of aspects of this crisis that is putting upward pressure on need for industrial spaces as well. But something like retail, I think you can imagine, is going to have a longer workout from this, because we have, you know, not just people temporarily curtailing some of their spending at stores that would be in the malls and other components of the retail real estate sector, but we also have this crisis perhaps kind of accelerating a trend in, for instance, retail that we've seen for about 20 years, which is a slow movement from bricks and mortar spending into online spending. And, you know, this isn't going to be, you know, this is going to be the time when people start spending 100% online going forward, that people are going to be happy to get back and start spending in malls again, you know, believe you me. But nonetheless, this will be a little bit of a nudge. There'll be some more segments people will get more comfortable with. And so that will also have a bit of a longstanding impact perhaps on the retail industry. But it's important to say that this is just a continuation of that 20-year trend, perhaps just a mild acceleration of that during this period of time. But without a doubt, it's going to be a rocky road until we work out of this situation, which might be, you know, several quarters for that segment.